So this is going to be a little bit of a large video compared to normal ones. And here is the mount that is sent from DeAgostini to mount the Millennium Falcon to, they say, like a wall or something like that. It's basically just a LCD mount, wall mount. And, you know, there's no way that I'm using this sucker. You know, for one, here's the holes that the mount uses. So they give you these little standoffs, and then it's going to cover up, what, a third of the bottom? The standoffs are so that, you know, it doesn't interfere with the gun of the turret and all. But anyway, I'm not about to use that. So here is a metal plate, which I've cut to length, that I'm going to use to support the Falcon. And these four holes on the ends will screw into the metal frame, and this plastic rod that I attached in the middle will support the mount, this camera mount right here. So the plan is this camera mount, the quarter 20 head of the mount, I've tapped the plastic rod in the center and the mount will screw right into it. And that will support the bottom of the Falcon, and the metal aluminum frame will support the weight of the internal frame of the Falcon. So here you can see my aluminum frame cut to length for the center section, and I have already drilled the four holes into the internal frame and tapped them for 440 screws, I believe is what I used. And you can see the plastic rod here is a 1-inch rod, and it's the same diameter as the center of the turret window. So the camera mount will screw into the hole, it'll support that turret window, and the aluminum frame will take the rest of the stress and will support the weight of the Falcon because it's attached to the framework of the Falcon itself. And we just tighten the four screws to the frame. And it's rather strong, you know. I know this is only the lower hull, but it supports it no problem at all. So this way the model won't be resting on just the turret window, but it'll be supported by the entire frame. And here it is being held up by my camera mount. So now that I figured out that, these four holes here, it's time to get rid of them. And you can see this one has a little edge which sticks out, so I'm going to have to sand all that down and grind it all down. So to start with, I'm just going to fill all the holes with some modeling putty. And there's all four holes filled. And once dried, I'm going to start sanding all the holes down smooth to the hull. So at this point, it's nice and smooth, all the holes. Again, this one, you know, you got this curved area here. So what I'm going to have to do is I'm going to grind that down and try to stair step it to match the way it should look. So with my Dremel tool and the grinding stone, I'm going to start by grinding it down. Once ground down, I'm going to sand again and try to make it look stair-stepped. And here, you know, you can see the way it is. And I cut little notches in it to match the way the model originally looked. And then it's time to do a little primer on the holes. You can see a little mark there, so I need to fill in a little more putty and do a little more sanding and get it a little smoother. So now that I've done that, you can see here it looks pretty good, and I cut the notches out the way it's supposed to be with an X-Acto blade. But I got these panel lines here that need to be done. And here's the notches on the other front end. And you can see the difference between the real model and mine, how the panel lines don't meet. So the first thing I'm going to do is draw out where the panel lines are supposed to go. And then give a little scarring with the X-Acto blade just to mark it off. And then I'm going to start out with the scribe, and I'm going to carve the panel lines back into the hull. And there it is, all carved back out and painted with primer. Not perfect, but it looks much better than having big old holes for mounting. So a shot of the body color. And then I'm going to have to do a little bit of black wash in the panel lines. And a little bit of weathering to get it to match the rest of the body color. And here you can see where I did the black wash in the panel lines to highlight the panel lines. This is a shot of the actual filming miniature, and you can see right here that there's a little raised bump on the hull. So I want to add that using this piece of styrene to my model to make it more accurate to the filming miniature. So I'm lining up my styrene with one of the other ones on the side to make sure I cut mine to the same size and shape. And then I'm just gonna go ahead and cut through the styrene and make my little raised panel bump. And now that I have the right width, I'm gonna mark it here to make sure I have the same length as the other ones that are on the bottom. And give it a little cut. And then I'm just gonna glue it into place right where it belongs over that panel line. And I got it on the end of this toothpick here. And I'm just gonna stick it down. And hold it down till it dries, and there we go. I've replaced the little raised panel bump. It looks pretty good. I'm pretty happy with it. While not perfect, you know, it'll do. Then a little airbrushing on all the areas to make them match the rest of the bottom hull. So here is the hull before with the four holes, and here's my hull now after filling in the holes and repainting. And here we have assembled landing gear. I'm not intending to display my Falcon with the landing gear, but I put them together basically to support the lower hull while I work on it. And you just pull off these magnetic plates off the bottom. And as I did with my mandible, I put magnets in my landing gear and then attached magnets here to the inside so that I can take my landing gear and drop it right in place, and it's secured. That way I can remove them easily and put them back in. So I'm just putting all of them into place so that I can flip my Falcon over and start working on the interior. And here's where the real fun modifications begin. I don't have video of this, sorry, but I bought a 3D printed navigation chair, primed it, painted it black, did the cushions on the seat, and then scraped up the black a little bit, and I have myself a navigation seat. With my gun turret photo etching, it came with a little miniature headset. So I made the headset, wrapped it around a paintbrush handle to curve it, painted it silver, the little ends black, and I attached it to my chair with a very thin wire to make it look like it's connected for communications. And here it is inside the hold. So here's the piece that supports the hold, and you can see it's a lot deeper than my pit that I made. So I'm extending my pit with some styrene walls on the side. Then I'm gluing in some more greeblies from an old model. Added some more piping, painted it all up. Cut a little hole in the side here. threw in a little LED to light it up more, and then put it right inside my hold there. And here's a before and after shot showing how much deeper it is. So I purchased some 3D printed crates and barrels to go on the inside of the hold, and you can see those here. There's two big barrels, an oil can, and some crates in a tray. Started out by priming them, as usual. So to start out, I'm taking the crates, and I've attached them with toothpicks, and I'm going to spray them with silver, and I'm airbrushing them here with silver paint. Then what I'm doing is I'm going to spray them with some hairspray, and this will protect the silver coat of paint. Then I'm going to spray the barrels and these little boxes a white color. And the crates, I'm now airbrushing black on top of the silver now that the hairspray has dried. And here we have the crates and barrels painted with their base coats. For the crates, next up what I'm going to do is just take an X-Acto blade and I'm just going to start scraping them up. Look like they've been all used and been thrown around, and you know they're supposed to be metal crates, so I'm making them look all scuffed up and weathered. And there you can see them there. Then I'm going to use some pastels, some rust, and a little dust color, and I'm just gonna add a little bit more weathering and make them look a little certainly like they're well-used pieces of crates that have been through a lot of transport. For my barrels in these other boxes, I'm starting out with a black wash just to highlight all the details around the barrels. And there you have the barrels with their first coat of black wash. Then I'm going to add a little bit of a brown wash, rust colored wash to them to make them look more weathered. And then I did the same to the other little boxes and that tray. And here's my oil can that I painted kind of a dirty yellow color. Weather it with black wash and rust and such. And here you have all of them fully painted. And after a bit of moving them around inside the hold in different placements, I came upon a layout that I liked. So I'm just gluing all the pieces down into my particular layout. And I've got a couple up top there you can see above the piping, and then the rest of them down below. So here's another thing, this short corridor on the starboard side, you know, you can see through it, it just ends, so there's a black hole. I didn't want to spend money buying more parts, so an easy way, I got this mirror from a compact, which I broke, and I'm just going to use that, adding a few drops of super glue to the end of this corridor. And then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take the mirror and I'm gonna attach it, glue it right to the end, and without having to spend a bunch of money on parts and actually physically extending it, I got a poor man's corridor extension. I think it looks pretty good. So now we have the forward hold wall, and in the real thing there's lights here in between the beams. And I've been wanting to put lights in there for a while. So by just eyeballing it, which is probably not the way to do it, I'm drilling with a 1 millimeter bit holes in the backside that I will then take these 0403 SMD LEDs, which are extremely small as you can see here, and I'm going to insert them in the little hole which goes right underneath that lip on the other side, and that will illuminate. So now that I know it's going to work, I drill the other four holes out very carefully. Again, just eyeballing it. There was really no way for me to measure. And here you can see the lights in there. And I'm just going to use some Elmer's glue to secure them. I don't want to use super glue or anything. If by some chance these were to burn out, you know, the Elmer's glue will hold them in place, but it'll also come off really easily and I can pull them out and replace them if need be. So now that I have all four lights glued into the wall here, it's time to test them out. And I'm very pleased with how this looks. I think it looks very nice. And then we also have the aft wall where the beams of the actual kit just go short. So I made these little styrene pieces here. There's a thick styrene in the middle and thin styrene on either side to make that little ledge. And I am going to glue these extension beams onto the kit beams. And here you can see I've attached all four beams. Then I cut two strips of styrene here, one for the bottom to diffuse the light, one for the wall. And I've glued them together, painted the wall portion the same color gray, and the bottom I'm just leaving as a diffusion. And then I'm going to take this piece and just drop it right in behind my beam extensions, and I've made myself a little light box, which fits pretty well. So I got an LED strip, attached it to a thick strip of styrene that I cut, and secured it to make it stiff. And then I'm taking some I-beam styrene, and what I'm going to do here is cut it to my desired length, and I'm going to make little legs to hold the LED strip so that it won't be right up against the light box. And this will give it a little gap there, and it can just glow inside my little box that I've made. So now that all those are secured, I've soldered some wires onto the end of the LED strip to power it up. And I'm grinding down a little area here for the wires to come out. And then I'm dropping my little LED strip right into my light box. Then I filled in any little gaps with some putty so there's no light leak. And then finally I've made another little strip here that I've painted with the metallic gray. And I'm going to cap off the top and glue it down to fill in the light box. And here we have it on and working. And again, I'm quite pleased with the way this turned out as well. So here we have my gunner port that I made back in part 4. And my plan has been to light it with an LED strip. I've just been needing to figure out exactly how I'm going to mount the lighting and make it all work. I want it to wrap around so that everything will light up, and I have this LED strip and this little connector to power it. So what I came up with is I took this water cup here, and I'm just going to cut out a section to attach the LED strip to because it keeps a curved shape, as you can see right here. Then it wraps right around the gunner port, as you can see. So the LED strip will just secure right here to the back of the hold. But what I'm going to do is I want it to go over here a little more, so I'm going to notch out the plastic a little bit so that I have an area for it to rest on. So the one end will rest on this little hull here, and the other end will secure to the back wall of the hold. So I'm going to bend back the cup here so that there's an area to glue to the back wall. As you can see here, those will be the two points where it will secure to the wall. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut out a little piece here for my LED to fit through, and then I'm going to secure the LED strip to the plastic cup. And here it is attached with my connector to power it up. So this is just a temporary fit, just to make sure it all works out well. So I'm just using a piece of tape and I'm securing it where I'd like it to go. And then the gunner port is supposed to be secured to the upper hull, like so. And then when you put the upper hull on, the gunner port drops right into position. When it drops into position, I turn the lights on and it illuminates the gunner port. And again, I'm quite pleased with this and I think it'll work out pretty well. Ah, the engine grill. So this is what comes with the kit. Just a plastic sheet with painted on grill work. So I got this photo etched grill from Paragraphics. And it consists of three photo etched pieces of grill work that will need to be glued together. As you can see here, it's quite nice looking. And it comes with this diffusion piece to go behind the grill that's white with an outer glow of blue. And that'll just fit right behind the grill work, so it'll look like the engine is illuminating through the metal grill. So for starters, I need to cut out these three strips of grill. And now I have all three strips cut out and they fit together like so. The middle piece overlaps the two end pieces. So I'm gonna glue them together. And here we have all three pieces glued together, making one long engine grill strip. And the strip then will just fit right over this diffusion piece. So next up, what I need to do is I'm gonna tape down the diffusion and I'm gonna cut it out around my metal etched grill so that it's the exact same size. And here we have it cut to size. Then it's time to prime it. And then spray it with the body color. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to use some black airbrush and just kind of dirty it up a little bit, like it's, you know, been through some heat. And then take some super glue and I'm going to put super glue, drop some down into the little ledge here where this fits into, and glue it into position. And I have the film glued to the back side of the grill as well. And here is the original kit grill that comes with the model, which doesn't look bad, but you know. And here we have the new photo etched grill, which I like much better, and it looks more realistic to me, more like the actual movie. So that's it for my modifications. So I will leave you with some stills of my completed cargo hold.